Boardroom Bound, episode 68.
A key differentiating skill set from a success perspective between a corporate position and a board position is being a servant leader when you sit at a board table.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of Boardroom Bound. My name is Alexander Lowry, and this is the podcast dedicated to intentional leadership in the boardroom. My goal is to give new and aspiring directors the tips, tactics, and strategies necessary to transform your confidence and build a successful career as a board director. Quick reminder, you can get all of today's show notes at podcast.gordon.edu. In today's show, we'll be speaking with Sylvia Prickle. She's an IT Service Management Certified Professional and Six Sigma Black Belt. She's a veteran IT executive with a proven track record of leading, managing, and delivering highly successful businesses. And she works at United Airlines, where she is a managing director of digital technology. She currently serves on the board of Association for Information Technology Professionals, chairs the WebServes Board, technical director of Kumbaya's Board, and the first woman Metropolitan Club Corp Board Chair. She's also the president of the Women's Business Resource Group at United, and was recently aired on the WGN Women on the Move TV series. Now, in today's show, we're going to be talking with Sylvia, and I'm personally very excited about this because she and I are on the board together of Kumbaya, an organization we both believe is doing well while doing lots of good in the world. So it'll be great to dig into her story a little bit, unpack that. How did she begin a board career? I love that we're talking about a woman in IT and how she's leveraged that expertise and brought that forward to bear for different organizations. It's such a hot topic, both of those things, more board diversity about females on boards, but also we're hearing about more companies recognizing the tech world is changing everything and how do we grow and develop in it. So it'd be wonderful to hear about how she has intentionally been building her brand, growing into the board space and positioning herself for the long-term opportunity. She's got a busy full-time job today. She's not looking to take on a massive portfolio of board opportunities, but she might for down the road. And in many ways, we talk about that on this show. How do we position ourselves for the long-term success? So let's jump into the show and hear Sylvia's story. Sylvia Prickle, welcome to the Boardroom Bound podcast.
Well, thank you very much, Alexander.
Delighted to have you here today. And we were joking about it before we came on air that we have a board experience together, which is a fun way. We've actually never met in person yet. We've seen each other's names back and forth as we work for Kumbaya and a company that's doing some good while also doing well in the world, which is what attracted me to it. So we'll be able to spend some time on it. But maybe that's a good example of how to start out here. Of you're someone who has lots of different things in your portfolio, I will call it, of board opportunities, and you have to be choosing about how you spend your limited time and your effort. Maybe Kumbaya is a great place for us to start. What was it that attracted you to that opportunity and thought, this is where I should invest some of my resources?
Oh, Kumbaya is absolutely an organization that is really intended to do good for the world. And I love the phrase, bring the last billion and connect them back into the population, leveraging technology by giving them access to the internet. So that is the mission of Kumbaya, is to really connect the last billion, enabling them with solar-powered computer equipment so that they can connect to the internet and then be exposed to the web, for whether it is for education, medicine, urban renewal, even businesses within the third world countries of Africa. So an excellent organization which really appealed to me and allowed me, given my technology background, an opportunity to give back to society.
And I think about it similarly. So I think for many of the people listening to this show, there's a portfolio mentality that comes. Some people might say, I want to do several nonprofits as a way to give back. Others think maybe I'll start there and that will give me the experience and the background I needed to get to a paid board role later. There's other people that are doing a combination of those sorts of things. And similarly for me, Kumbaya was one of those felt like I could help this business to be a successful business, but also while we're doing that, we're really helping other people. It's not ancillary to the business, it's a main part of the business. And I know for you, 2017, when you joined Kumbaya, was a busy year where you, I think you joined several other boards as well. So I'm guessing this is sort of a great live case study in the last couple of years of how you've built this opportunity and laid the groundwork for yourself. But as we build up to that, maybe we can take a step back and just start at the beginning. So you've been at United Airlines for a long time, very successful executive. I think you were touching on it a bit there, IT background and experience. And it's probably that success that's allowed you to leverage off into the board roles. Maybe you can just give us some color around that.
Absolutely. I think in today's world, any business, every business, profit, nonprofit, corporate, whatever, public, private, all have to rely on technology of some sort. And obviously, cybersecurity is a huge aspect of protecting any organization. Mm-hmm. And that makes me believe that someone with a technology background and a deep understanding of what's happening in the world of technology is really a vital role, a critical role on the board. And I think many organizations are beginning to realize that and pulling in those expertise alongside with, obviously, subject matter experts around financials, around compensation and management. Now technology, and in particular cybersecurity, as well as innovation in order to drive business, is also a big part of any company portfolio.
And I imagine just growing more exponentially important by the day, the way the world is headed. And I'm guessing based on your LinkedIn profile, I admitted to doing some stalking on you before the show on LinkedIn, and I'm guessing it was the Association of IT Professionals, perhaps, where your sort of main board experience started. Was that right?
Yes, I have been associated with many different technology organizations, AITP, Association for Information Technology Professionals. Ooh, it's a mouthful.
It is.
is my most recent one. I am on the board there and have been for several years. And what we do is not only enable technologists and professionals and executives to get together and network to discuss and brainstorm and solution for day-to-day problems and challenges, but also to provide educational opportunities, whether via special interest groups. So whether that is what we call now new DevOps, right? The way of operating, the way of developing software and products. Or cybersecurity, or infrastructure management, or having special interest groups for CIOs to get together and talk about the day-to-day challenges of just running a business. So AITP has been really a wonderful organization for me to engage in personally, professionally, and also participate in terms of providing guidance as part of the board.
Now, when we think about beginning a board career, sounds like a great opportunity for you with an organization that has robust infrastructure, has social media, has awareness, lots of people to network with. It seems like a great place. How did that begin? Did they approach you? Did you decide this is something you wanted to do and you approached them? How did it start?
It was actually at a networking, so it was mutual. It was at a networking event that I attend. I do spend time to ensure... Or let me put it this way, I do take time to ensure that I network, not only internally, but more importantly, externally, with peers and colleagues from other organizations and other industries. I think that's absolutely vitally important in any career, and especially even more important as you move up in your career,
right,
is to be a well-connected, a well-known individual. And so in a networking event, I ran into an individual who happened to be the chair and the president of AITP Chicago, and offered me an opportunity to sit in, to participate and attend, and just the relationship grew from there and to the point where I was asked to participate as a member on the board.
All right, so that's a great example of being an expert in your field, building that reputation while intentionally doing it within the networking, so having it all come together. And so you've landed this board seat, and when you got there, did you feel like, this is great, I want to do more of these? How did you go from that first one to the next opportunity?
That's exactly what happened, Alexander. I felt I was adding value. I enjoyed the engaging conversations. It was stimulating, and I wanted more. I did. I wanted more. And so I began to reach out to my network for other opportunities. Kumbaya came about via another... web organization that I belong to, that I subscribe to, and I thought, hey, this is a great opportunity for me to give back and share some of the experiences and knowledge and expertise I have in technology. So that's how I landed with Kumbaya. I am an avid member and participant of the Chicago City Metropolitan Club, which is part of Club Corp. It's a member club, and in my networking and engagement in the various activities of that club, I was tapped on the shoulder to see if there was interest in participating in their board of governors, of which I was, because I love the club and I love the members, and anything I can do to advocate for the club and advocate, more importantly, for the members of the club, I was willing to do and extend myself and my time to do so. And so I volunteered to sit on the board of governors. Through an interview process, I was selected, and today, that was about 8 years ago, and today I chair that board. I'm very proud to say that I'm the first woman chair of the board.
Congratulations.
Of governors of the Metropolitan. Yes, thank you very much, and it has been a very rewarding experience, very educational, and really something I enjoy. And then that grew from all their nonprofit organizations. There's so many nonprofit organizations that are in desperate need of expertise, from professionals, corporate professionals that have years of experience in any particular domain. And so I landed an opportunity at an organization called WebServes. They are a nonprofit organization that provide technology services to other nonprofit organizations. So they developed an ecosystem of their own within the nonprofit community. And I provide guidance and expertise with my background in helping the nonprofit WebServes to, you know, how do they grow their business, how do they market their business, and how do they reach out, and ultimately the goal of becoming national one day. Right now they're just located off the East Coast, but we're looking to grow that organization nationally.
Well, I think you've touched on something great here, and we had a previous episode, I believe it was number 7 with Beth Francis, where we talk about just what you said, where nonprofits are in desperate need of the right talent to have them around them and encourage them, and you've identified that as an area that you can bring that special skill that you have to, and that is a gift. And for you, how do you think about it? Do you feel like, I have a very busy corporate plate with United and serving on these nonprofits that I care about and believe in is a great way, and this is exactly what I want to do for you? Or is it also a stepping stone that this will allow you to do additional things down the road? How do you think about it?
A little of both. You know, first and foremost, from a priority perspective, is obviously my family. Secondly, is my day job, which is the world I live in today at United Airlines. And, you know, that left some additional time on my hands to allocate to other things. And participating on boards seemed to fit that that gap. Board participation is absolutely something you have to commit yourself to and dedicate the time when you need to dedicate the time. And that's I think, the difference between a corporate day-to-day job and a board job. It is a job, but it is a job that comes and goes in spurts, right? So there may be some days you spend, you know, 100% of your time on board work, and then there may be days and weeks that you don't have to worry about it. So it allows me to fill my spare time with what I think is very valuable and meaningful work, and that way I can continue to live what most would call a well-balanced life that is still rewarding without overdoing it.
I think that's the key, because there are probably a lot of individuals who think, I definitely want to take on a board, and even if we just use a nonprofit world, the amount of time and energy and the type of commitment can vary so wildly between little bits here and there versus a lot, especially if there's maybe a head of an organization change or organizations combined, what have you. So you've been very intentional about it and careful and thoughtful, which I think is a great lesson for all of us to apply. And I would almost call it baby stepping, right? So you went into one, I agree, I like this, I want this. And you gave a great example through the Metropolitan, the Club Corp, where you've intentionally invested in a group that you like, but also probably knowing it was going to be good networking, right?
Absolutely. And to that point, it is a great stepping stone, because at some point in my career, right, I'm gonna look to the days of retirement. But I know myself well enough to know that sitting on the back porch swing is not my thing. So I'm gonna want to continue to be engaged. But I don't want to be engaged so much that, you know, I'm 100% committed, but I still have my fingers in the pulse of the community, and especially, continuing to learn and grow and understand what's happening in the world of technology. And being on the board and being on several boards, whether it's profit, for-profit, non-profit, whatever, to me that doesn't play a big role in terms of what kind of board it is, and there are many different kinds, but how much value can I bring to the table, and is it something that really makes me feel good in terms of the ability to give back, I think is really important in continuing to enrich my life and my future.
I like the way you've described it there, and I think another great lesson is you're planning ahead, and you're thinking about perhaps a board portfolio down the road, again, could be a mix between for-profit and non-profit, but you're positioning yourself there for success, not only in getting the experience and the titles, but you talked a lot about networking at the beginning. Right? Clearly for yourself, that is a key through everything you do. Can you give us a sense about how you're perhaps networking while you're in these board seats now and what you're planning to do to use that as you go forward?
Everyone you meet, right, is that whole 6 degrees of separation. There's a connection, and it just baffles me when I will run into a new member, a new director on the board, or even a new member at the club that I associate with that happens to know, right, a mutual client or colleague or employee, and that starts the conversation. And you know, we are all connected. It's just a matter of finding that common thread, and sometimes it's it just comes very in out of coincidence, right, through a very simple and water cooler kind of a conversation, and then you find out that you have something in common, and then that leads to a much more meaningful conversation and a much more meaningful relationship, which then allows you to continue to build your network outward.
It is a small world after all, and a great example is Kumbaya, where you and I got to know each other now because of that affiliation working together, which is how this podcast came about. And as we think about for our listeners, sort of your experience as a great case study, I would love to hear about the biggest challenge that you experienced as you went from being a corporate executive to being on a board, because they're very different roles, very different opportunities. What was it like for you as you learned to adjust to the new responsibilities?
Yeah, Alexander, I'd love to share, because I think this is a key differentiating skill set from a success perspective between a corporate position and a board position, and that is being, and that is of being a servant leader when you sit at a board table. It, you know, my current role, I have a very large organization that I am accountable for and accountable to deliver, right, to my organization. And with that, I need to exhibit direct leadership qualities and skill sets that drives outcome. Okay, drives outcome. Now, absolutely, when you sit on a board, your responsibility is also to help drive outcome, but the approach is very, very different. And what has helped me is to develop my sense of servant leadership, understanding that my role is to provide a service. My role is to enable an outcome through influence and through conversation and collaboration and bringing people together. That, I think, is the greatest skill set to learn and master in any board seat.
And I'm going to equate that partly to EQ, right? So not just having a very high IQ, but how do you get things done where you're no longer delivering, you're influencing, you're suggesting, you're coaching, you're giving strategy. And it's interesting, the phrase that you used was exactly what was duplicated on, I believe it was episode 2 with Steve Bartlett, the servant leadership, that exact same mentality. And it's, you can clear just hearing the way you're describing it, that it's the way that you approach it. And you probably also have to think about finding the boards where that is the right fit. So you and I joked before that there are different types of boards. Some are very aggressive, some are very passive, some are very strong engagement styles with each other. Can you also give us a sense for that? So you know who you are, you know the value you bring in your skill set. How do you find the place where it's the right fit for you to bring that?
That's a great question, Alexander. And I think it's a double-edged sword, to be honest with you. I think there's pros and cons. And on one hand, I like the fact that there is, you know, diversity is not only in diversity of gender or color or background, but it's diversity of thought. Mm-hmm. And I really appreciate a board that is diverse in thought and opinion. And what that means is that sometimes you will have, you know, members on the board that disagree, members on the board that have very strong opinions. You have some members that are quiet and just like to listen. So all different styles, right, of leadership and engagement, I think that's healthy as opposed to, you know, looking for the same style of leadership to fill all the board seats. It's another dimension of diversity that I think is important. Now, on the flip side, what that also brings are some challenges, right? Because what you're trying to do is get agreement and alignment around the board and provide a direction for management to take that is, you know, everyone rowing in the same direction, so to speak, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't want to have a board that cannot agree, because that just does not provide any value for the organization, for management, right? So being able to lead a board and continue to be a servant leader, right? So you have to lead by influence and not necessarily by direction or action, can be a little bit more challenging when you have a very diverse board of opinions. But the outcome, I think, is very, very strong and well thought through and well thought out. And of all my experiences, although I can't say I have all that many years of experience, I will say it's always proven to be very, very successful.
And I like the way you described it. So diversity is the buzzword in the boardroom today. Mm-hmm. And the easy way people tend to think about it is by gender, male and female.
Right.
And there's no question we want more diversity in general on a board. And there's one CEO I know who describes his board to me, and we talked about it. I said, is there a difference between your board members? He said, absolutely. On general, my men will talk first and think later. And the opposite for the women, they'll think first and then they'll talk later. And he said, I like both of that, right? Because it helps me have a balanced view. And in the way you've described it, broadening it out, is not just background and color and gender, but all of the diversity of thought. And in general, for all of us, I think we want to be aiming more for inclusion and engagement. Is that the right way to think about it? How do you approach that?
Absolutely. It is all about inclusiveness and engagement. And I think it's extremely important. But I will tell you, like I said, it does create challenges as well. So let me, quick story about a recent situation and how I approached it. And I leave it up to the audience as to whether that was a good approach or not. I don't know. The outcome was good.
Well, so we love the war story, so this is great.
So there's a major organizational change within the company of this board, and a complete rebranding. Now, when you rebrand an organization, it's a very passionate conversation because there's so many different perspectives in which direction a brand should go and who your target audience is and how you direct that brand and how you create that brand and how you market that brand. So a lot of opinions within the company, and that generated a lot of opinions within the board. And quite frankly, there were a few people that kind of liked the brand the way it was, right? There were a few people in the company as well as a few people on the board that didn't really want the company to change, right? Because they liked it the way it was. And it's like, it's not broken. Why are we fixing something that's not broken? But evolution of every company has to evolve. And if it doesn't evolve, they become extinct. And we've seen that time and time again with many organizations. And so it is really, I think, the responsibility of the management team within the company to see that they have to evolve. And it's absolutely the responsibility of the board to ensure that the company evolves, right, and continues to stretch themselves and continues to adapt to the new ways of the world and to the new generations and to the workforce. And sometimes that's scary. That's very scary. And change is very hard, as we all know. So in this situation, there was dissension among the board, right? There were some people that just said, hey, I do not want to change. The company's doing fine. The financials are doing well. Leave it alone. And then there were some that say, hey, no, we have got to change, right? We've got to rebrand ourselves. We've got to market ourselves. So now, the good news is there's some really passionate debates on the board, right? How do you get consensus? How do you get alignment? And as the chair, those are situations that can become extremely challenging because you have to maintain that servant leadership approach. You cannot, and it's very politically charged, right? So you also want to ensure you're engaging everyone. Everyone has the opportunity to talk, even those that are extremely vocal. You need to let them talk, as well as those that are very quiet and feel overshadowed. You need to draw them back in because they're probably pushing away from the table, saying this is a little bit too politically charged for me to kind of engage in. But you have to, as the chair of the board, or the president of the board, or whichever leading role you have to constantly scan the room, look at all the members, look at all the body language, and ensure that everyone has an equal opportunity to participate. Because if you can do that, the outcome is, in my opinion, going to prove the best, going to be, you know, provide for the best results. And so, what I did in this particular situation, because it was so sensitive and because it was so politically charged, we created a smaller group. The board that I sit in consists of 24 people, which you would think is not very big. But
it's big.
Okay, so it's big.
A lot of voices,
okay, so
to get on the same page.
A lot of voices, right? So we created a small committee. And the committee's mission was to kind of continue the conversation and vet through the pros and cons, right, and come back to the board with a recommendation or a couple of proposals. And so I think what that does is and on the committee you have to be careful to ensure that you choose, you know, objectively select folks that, you know are going to participate, engage, and be able to look at all sides of the equation objectively and unbiased, and that way they can come back. So the conversation is within a smaller group. It's a little bit easier to manage, right? They still can get alignment, consensus, and then hopefully that committee then comes to the table, and as one force, fully aligned with a recommendation, comes now to the board, to the remaining members, and says, hey, you know what, we've had these dialogues, we've had these conversations, we've debated this, and here is collectively what we think we should do. And then that proposal now gets vetted with the rest of the board. But it seems like, since this committee had taken the burden, it's almost like they took the burden off the table, right? And worked through that challenge, worked through all those emotions, and then placed the results of that back on the table. It made it easier for everybody to digest, even those that were at first completely against the idea, saying, you know what, if this committee thinks it's the right thing, so it's not just one person thinks it's the right thing to do, or it's not two people, or it's not, you know, a political stance or motivation, but it's really truly a committee, the results of a committee that truly vetted this, then I think those individuals then start to come back to the table, right? And say, okay, yeah, maybe we should try this, right? And that's how I was able to gain alignment and consensus and, you know, a direction, a smoother direction moving forward, so that we could obviously help management in terms of what we think and what are some of the, you know, decisions that we made or guidance that we can provide to management and their approach.
So Sylvia, I think that was a great example of conflict management, which is going to happen in the boardroom, much like it does in our everyday lives, in the corporate world and the businesses that we're working in. You've got people that feel passionate about an organization. Hopefully that's why they're involved, and that can go in lots of different directions. So I think that was a great example, especially being a leader of a board and what that looks like and feels like. And as I think about how we bring some of these different threads together, all our wonderful ideas and values, if someone is sitting here thinking, this is exactly what I want to do, I need to perhaps learn some of these skill sets, start down this path, what do you tell them are the one or two key things that they should be working on?
You know, again, it's the ability not to get, it's like you said, Alexander, before, it's being thoughtful first before action. So that's number one. You need to make sure that, in my opinion, everyone around the table feels valued and their input is important. So understanding how to read people and understanding how, you know, getting to know each of the members and getting to know what type of personality. So there's lots of personality tests out there these days, and mm-hmm. I took several of them. I don't know. Have you taken one?
Yeah.
I'm sure you have,
yeah.
Right? Those personality tests are absolutely critical in terms of understanding different personalities and different motivations. Now, even though, as a board, although it doesn't sound like a bad idea, maybe I'll even try it one day. It would be great for the board to do a personality mm-hmm. or a leadership assessment so that everyone can learn what type of a leadership, what type of personality they have, because I think that really brings people together. But even if the board doesn't take such an assessment, as a leader on the board, if you understand what those assessments look like and how they work and recognize that people are different, and understand your own leadership skills, your strengths, and your opportunities, that, I think, definitely is one way to help prepare for being on the board. And conflict, as you mentioned, conflict management and being able to facilitate through conflict management is absolutely critical. Because if you cannot do that effectively, every board is going to run into conflict.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't, then they're not... You know, in my opinion, if there's never any conflict, then they're not really adding or being as they're not really adding as much value as they possibly can, because I think it's through conflict resolution that you get to the next level of evolution, you know, and you really pull a company forward. So conflict management is really critical, I think.
I would agree. A board's job at some times is to make healthy challenges, to ask probing questions, and that should lead to a healthy dialogue and debate at times.
Exactly. Exactly.
Well, Sylvia, thank you so much for being part of the Boardroom Bound podcast. And what would be the best way for our audience to contact you if they'd like to follow up?
I am on LinkedIn, Sylvia Prickle. That's probably the best way to connect with me via email or a message. Just say, hey, I heard you on the podcast, and I'd be happy to connect.
Well, good. Well, I will make sure we put that in the show notes. And we were delighted to have you on the show today. And thank you so much for sharing your insights and helping all of us to be more boardroom bound.
Thank you, Alexander, for the invitation. I greatly appreciate it.
That's it for this episode of Boardroom Bound. I really enjoyed chatting with Sylvia Prickle. It was a pleasure for me simply because we serve on a board together at Kumbaya, so lots of fun to get to know her story in more depth than I'd ever heard before, but also heard how she is building her brand and her reputation as a woman in the IT industry, using that to land board positions, which probably position her for something much bigger down the road as she moves on to perhaps the second act of her career. Now, I'd encourage you to head over to podcast.gordon.edu, where you can get links to all the resources we talked about today. And I'd also ask that if you enjoyed this episode or any of the other episodes we've heard before on this show, that you would give us 30 seconds of review. If you open up iTunes or Stitcher or Google Play or wherever you're listening to this, if you give us an honest rating and review, that will be incredibly helpful for us. I appreciate it personally, but it's also the best way we have to share news about this show. I'd also encourage you to subscribe and stay tuned in because every week we're working hard to bring you top quality content. And thanks for joining me in this episode of the show. I can't wait to share more stories and strategies from brilliant business minds with you again next week. Remember to keep tuning in to be boardroom bound.